friends and family of consorting with the devil, gathering around huge bonfires and repeating chants that condemn the poor creatures to the flame. The lost souls cry out in agony as the flames grow higher and higher.
Hey everyone, welcome back to Cobble Lot Magic. I haven't posted a video in a while. Hopefully you took some time to start reading through and doing some studying based upon what we had read and studied so far. As far as the curriculum goes for the Neophyte grade, I had suggested to possibly read Garden of Pomegranates by Israel Regarde, The Tree of Life, by Israel Regarde, amazing book, or The Mystical Kabbalah by Dion Fortune, and to start familiarizing yourself with Kabbalah. You're not going to learn Kabbalah overnight. It's going to be a lifelong practice, okay? And it was important because we were at a point to where we were going to be looking at the middle pillar, okay? And I'm just going to start reading through this, and we're going to discuss it as we go, okay? So, the middle pillar, the procedure for this essential Golden Dawn exercise appears here much as Israel Regarde revealed in his book, The Middle Pillar. You can perform this exercise standing or lying down within your circle. If you stand, turn around clockwise and face west for the middle pillar. If you lie down in your circle, point your head east and your feet west. Direct your attention to the sphere of light about an inch above the crown of your head. It is about half the diameter of a basketball, and all subsequent spheres you visualize will be the same size. Vibrate the Hebrew God name, Ahe. Can you see that? Right there. Ahe. When we're talking about vibrating a sound, do it your own way, okay? It can be hey, it can be hey. It's up to you, okay? You're your own magician. Don't let anybody else tell you how to do it. But make it sincere. Remember, you're going to get out of this what you put into it. It says, feel the vibration as though it comes from that sphere. Feel the whole universe harmonize with the sound. Vibrate it a total of 4 times. You may vibrate it 4 times. You may vibrate, you may say it like 8 times. The point is, okay, if you catch up to where we've been, we've talked about doing the Kabbalistic cross. Ata, Malkuth, Vegubara, Vegudla, Le'olam, Amen. Okay. and how that defines us in a cube of space. And then we did the lesser banishing ritual of the pentagram, which establishes a circle around us. Now, as we're doing all this, we're going into a more of a meditative state. As we're doing the middle pillar, we want to really feel that energy aligning with ourselves. And you'll notice that, matter of fact, I'm going to skip here for a second and I'm going to go to an image to describe this. Bear with me. Okay, so what we are looking at is the middle pillar on the tree of life itself, beginning with Kether, going to Da'at, then going to Tifereth, Hesod, and Malchut. This may look familiar to you as it aligns with chakras from the Eastern mysticism. So we're going to start at Kether. With that light, we're going to use the God word Elohim. Not Elohim. And then we're going to come down to Da'at. Okay. And there it's going to be Yod-Heh, Vav-Heh, Elohim. Or I always use Yehovah, Elohim. Between 4 and 8 times. Okay. Then we move down to Tifereth. And in Tifereth, in the book, it calls for A-I-O. Okay, I-A-O, which stands for Isis, Apophis, and Osiris. That's not the way I learned to do the middle pillar. The way I learned to do the middle pillar for this area, which is the heart chakra, it's Yod-Heh, Vav-Heh, which Yehovah or Yehovo, and Eloah, Vada'at. Okay, Eloah, Vada'at. Then we go down to Yesod, which is around the groin area. And the word there is Shaddai Alkai. Then we go to our feet, to Malkut, and we say Adonai Ha'aretz. Okay, once we've gone through that, and once again, so we're starting with Kether, we're going to Da'at, Tifereth, Yesod, Malchut. Okay. And we're wanting to focus on these areas. So we're starting at Kether. And we're drawing it. Once we expand that, we're coming down to Da'at. We're expanding that one. We're going down to Tifereth. We're expanding it. We're going down to Yesod, and we're expanding it. We're going down to Malkut, and we're expanding it. Okay, so we're building these energy centers. Okay, in Eastern mysticism, they would refer to this as activating your chakras. You're going to notice some similarities between this and Kundalini. It's the same thing. There's a reason for that. So once we've gone through, and once again, we'll go through it one more time. Hey, Yahovah Elohim, Yehovah Eloah Vadayat, Shaddai Alkai, Adonai Haaretz. Okay. And we're saying it several times as we can get that energy building. Now, you're supposed to visualize and feel the whole pillar of light traversing the height of your body. Feel it firmly rooted in the void over your head and firmly planted in the earth beneath your feet. Light is the essence of manifestation. It is carried forth into manifestation via darkness. Feel the density of your body showing forth the brilliance within, like darkness bringing forth light. Turn the attention to the sphere at the feet. Inhale as you draw a shimmering stream of white light up in an arc along the right side of the body and into the sphere overhead. Now what I do is if you visualize the caduceus, the two serpents around the staff, I start at the feet, at my hood, and I bring that light swirling up, okay? And it comes up to Kether, and then it comes back down the other direction, okay? It comes back up, and comes back down, okay? Anyway, exhale as you allow it to stream down the left side of the body and into the sphere at the feet. Doing it that way, you're bringing it up from the right and down to the left, bring it up from the right and down from the left, okay? And you keep doing that. Perform the same circulation of the light again, drawing it this time up the back and down the front of the body four times. Then draw the energy up through the center of the body into the sphere over the head. Pause for a moment, then allow the energy to explode from above like a fountain and rain down to the sphere at the feet. Do this circulation four times or more as desired. See the energy of the middle pillar expand gently, permeating an oval-shaped space around your body. Feel yourself floating in this light. The foundation of your being is pure brilliance on which you are suspended. Remain in this state for up to 20 minutes. Allow all thoughts and tensions to be consumed or extinguished by the brilliance. I'm going to stop right there for a couple minutes because I don't think that the book gives the middle pillar as much attention as it deserves. And it overlooks a few things. So, and I'm going to talk about something that's kind of like a pet peeve of mine. I was talking about this earlier today, and it seems that even some of the most enlightened magicians, some of the best magicians and the most knowledgeable, they still take their beliefs and they wrap them around a core that is flawed. And let me explain where I'm coming from with this. Something as simple as saying, okay, visualize the white light above your head and draw it down. Okay. What if I'm in Australia? I mean, that it sounds like I'm being snarky, but, you know, where is this light? Where in the universe is this light? It's inherently flawed, in my opinion, to look at it that way. So I have to understand that the universe unfolds, and that's what we're talking about here with the Kabbalistic cross and the lesser banishing ritual, the pentagram, and the middle pillar. These basic rituals that we're going to use for the rest of our lives. It's important to understand that this is an unfolding. It's a multi-dimensional process. So we're to quote from Doctor Strange, if you're a Marvel fan, we draw energy from other dimensions and use it and manipulate it. So is the light really up here? No, not really. It's unfolding all the time, okay? It's constantly unfolding and coming back in, unfolding and coming back in. We have to start thinking about things multidimensionally instead of just three dimensions plus time. Because, and this is really, really hard to explain, things are always in motion. So think about something unfolding, coming around, and then folding back into itself, and then unfolding, coming back around, and folding back into itself. And as that unfolding right here, that is our reality. That's where we live. And it's constantly devolving into the past, and the future is constantly unfolding. And that's what we're talking about here. How does magic work? Magic works because the future reality is in a state of flux. It's always being manifest. It's always being created. It's not a static thing that we're moving into. And that's where people get hung up, is people get hung up thinking that it's that time is a line and we're just moving along. And that's not true. Not at least that not in the way I understand Kabbalah and magic. As it's unfolding, what is the process of unfolding? That's what Kabbalah teaches us. Kabbalah teaches us that it starts with the first stirrings, the first start of a thought, and then it develops into more of a thought, and it starts to become reality as it moves through the tree. And that's that unfolding process. It starts back here with a first thought, and as it comes forward, it's becoming more and more and more solid until it manifests into Malchut, which is our reality, and then immediately disappears. Okay, and the next thing comes in, and the next thing comes in, and the next thing comes in, and it just keeps a continuous state. So, if I am trying to manifest a working, say I'm trying to, I don't know, just pull something out of my ass here. Say you're trying to get a raise, okay? Or you're trying to quit smoking and you want to have some willpower to quit smoking. Then you are focusing, using this meditative process of the Kabbalistic cross, the lesser banishing ritual, middle pillar, and then your meditation, you're going to meditate on certain things during your practice. And it may be that, you know, I want to quit smoking. That's your desire. And then what's happening is you're shooting that right up the middle pillar to Keter. As it comes back down through Da'at, remember Da'at is a cloud of chaotic potentials. Everything that can possibly exist exists within Da'at. And it draws what it needs from Da'at and it starts filtering down. Okay? And it removes what it doesn't need and it holds on to what it does need to manifest itself into what you're wanting. Now, this is not an instant process. You know, it's an unfolding process. So it starts slow. You may start to have some willpower, or you may have something happen. Like, you know, if you think about a cigarette, you're going to start getting nauseous. Something's going to happen to block it. That's the magic working, because you're tapping into the source code of reality, and you're shaping it as it's manifesting. Okay, does that make more sense? And does it give a little bit of the importance behind this middle pillar exercise? I mean, actually, the Kabbalistic cross, the lesser banishing ritual, and then the middle pillar. That's what these things do. Okay, that's the basis of how these things work, which is why we're learning them. It's why we practice them every single day. It's to get us in tune with that manifestation process, how things actually work, how they unfold, how they are constantly moving. Okay, we're up here while time is just constantly unfolding and devolving. Okay, so I wanted to take a couple of minutes and kind of harp on that, because it's so, in my opinion, it is so vital. Okay, now we'll go back to the book and we'll go to section 4 of the Neophyte, which is the Neophyte Meditation. The meditation comes from the textbook regarding Golden Dawn, page 52. Now, it's 52 of a certain version, not the version that I have, so you'll just have to look for it. But it's in there, it's easy to find if you go to the table of contents. So it says you may wish to either stand or to sit in your chair in the middle of a circle. If you do either, face east, or if you've been lying down for the middle pillar, you may continue to do so. Let the neophyte consider a point, a dot, okay? Just a dot, not a line, not a sheet, not a plane, not a cube, not a circle, a dot, okay? Consider a point as defined in mathematics, having position but no magnitude. And let him or her note the ideas to which this gives rise. Concentrating their faculties on this as a focus, let them endeavor to realize the immanence of the divine throughout nature in all her aspects. Okay, so we're going to talk about this for just a second. Once again, we're talking about a point. I believe that when I was talking about the Kabbalistic cross and how it establishes a point in space, in order to determine a location of anything in space, you have to have three dimensions. You have to start with that point. Okay, that's where things start. And it's really important when we start studying the Sefer Yetzirah, which is the book of formation. And it starts talking about how the universe was created. And I don't think that it's talking about it in a static form. Once again, we have to remember that these things are all multidimensional and things are in motion all the time. So when we start going through, and as we continue, I'm going to tell you right now, spoiler alert, it's going to tell you focus on the point, and then you're going to focus on a line, and then you're going to focus on three dimensions, and then you're going to focus on a plane, and then you're going to focus on a cube, and you're going to see how these things expand outward. Okay, how a dot unfolds into these things. Okay, that's the meditation. Is to focus just on the dot. It has a position, but it has no volume. It has no mass. There's nothing there except for location. Now, the additional exercises here are the four adorations. Now, I will tell you that I don't practice the four adorations. Please don't judge me for that. I won't judge you if you do. It's just not my thing. But there are some good takeaways from reading through them. So, the four adorations. This exercise comes from the beginning of Israel Regardi's book, The One-Year Manual. He presents them there as an ideal way to begin the discipline of ritual mysticism. Do these simple rituals at the assigned times of the day. And that's where you're going to see a problem. They affirm your connection to the journey of the sun through the heavens. The solar logos is central to the golden dawn. The sun corresponds to Tifereth, which is the first sphere of consciousness that epitomizes adeptship. In these exercises, you begin to learn how to zero in on that principle by acknowledging the solar disk and its varying aspects. These exercises also introduce you to the symbolism of ancient Egypt, in which the sun was usually the primary focus. The written assignment for this grade, the Compendium of Gods, will require you to do research at your library online in your assigned reading to acquaint yourself more with the Egyptian deities referenced in this exercise. In-depth study will repay you very well. Yes, I guess you can. Myself, I'm not with the Egyptian pantheon of gods. Myself, I'm dedicated to the Morgan. See my shirt? The Morgan. I'm dedicated to the aspects of the dark goddess, which I may talk about, and I will be talking about in another video. Some people are more at home with the Greek pantheon of gods, the Norse gods, the Celtic gods, Christian mythos, or the Egyptian pantheon. None of it is wrong. None of it is right. All of it is right. Okay? It depends on what you want to do. And I encourage you to find your own place and your own beliefs. So, in order to do these adorations effectively, you must perform the Neophyte signs. These are presented in the teachings of the Golden Dawn as secret gestures that exemplify the spirit of the Great. The Neophyte signs are the most important of all the grade signs in the Outer Order. There are two of them, the sign of the Enterer and the sign of Silence. And the second completes the first. And I use these during the pentagram rituals, and during the hexagram rituals, which come much later in the higher grades. So the sign of the Enterer is you draw your arms up, palms down, and push forward. Okay? And it's almost like opening a curtain, but what you're doing is you're sending energy out. Okay? And then you step back in the sign of silence. Two fingers to your lips. You recognize this? We used it in the banishing ritual of the pentagram. Jehovah. Okay? As we blasted that pentagram out in each direction with the God names. Okay? We drew the energy up and shot it out. Sign of the Enterer. Sign of silence. Okay, so sign of the Enterer, stand erect with your palms facing downward. Draw your hands up the sides of your body until they point, fingers forward at either side of your head. Step forward with your left foot and thrust your arms forward. This sign assists you in sending your energy forward to an object of adoration. It identifies you with that object, making a connection. The connection presumably can remain open even after the sign is completed, as is in the rituals of the pentagram and the hexagram. And a lot of other rituals that we'll be learning. And the sign of silence. This sign has the effect of withdrawing the energy projected in the sign of the Enterer and ending your identification with the object of adoration. It is also called the sign of Horus or Harpocrates, and its significance as such is endless. Standing upright, bring your left index finger to your lips as though telling someone to be quiet. Simultaneously stamp your left foot gently and firmly. So, once again, I mean, before I was doing it with this, with my right, but remember you're coming up like this, you're going to remain pointing in the Lesser Vanishing Ritual. You're going to step back, stomp your foot with the sign of silence, and you're going to turn to the next direction, okay? And then you're going to do the pentagram, sign of Enterer, go back around again. Okay? That's in the banishing ritual of the pentagram. So, Ra. At dawn or upon rising, face east, give the sign of the Enterer and say, Hail unto thee who art Ra in thy rising, even unto thee who art Ra in thy strength, who travelest over the heavens in thy bark at the uprising of the sun. Tehuti standeth in his splendor at the prow, and Rahur abideth at the helm. Hail unto thee from the abodes of night. Then give the sign of silence. Hathor, at noon, face south, give the sign of the Enterer and say, Hail unto thee who art Hathor in thy triumphing, even unto thee who art Hathor in thy beauty, who travelest o'er the heavens in thy bark at the mid-course of the sun. Tehuti standeth in his splendor at the prow, and Rahur abideth at the helm. Hail unto thee from the abodes of the morning. Then give the sign of silence. If you haven't figured it out, the bark, it's a boat. That's going in the sky. Tum, T-U-M. At sunset, face west, give the sign of the Enterer and say, Hail unto thee, who art Tum in thy setting. Even unto thee who art Tum in thy joy, who travelest over the heavens in thy bark, and at the going down of the sun, Tehuti standeth in his splendor at the prow, and Rahur abideth at the helm. Hail unto thee from the abodes of the day, and then give the sign of silence. Kephra, at midnight, or upon going to sleep, face north, give the sign of the Enterer, and say, Hail unto thee who art Kephra in thy hiding. Even unto thee who art Kephra in thy silence, who travelest o'er the heavens in thy bark at the midnight hour of the sun. Tehuti standeth in his splendor at the prow, and Rahur abideth at the helm. Hail unto thee from the abodes of the evening, and give the sign of silence. So those are the four adorations. They're great for helping to develop discipline. And another book that I have over here, Adventures of Amagus, the Thelemite edition. I use it because I like the rituals in it. It's a diary. And it's looking for you to do the adorations. Okay. Let's see here. There you go. In the back of the book, this is a really cool book, by the way. In the back of the book, it has, I'm just going to show you this. Okay. Daily rituals. Okay. The mudras. The neophyte signs. Then you go into the elemental grades. Okay. And it gives you all the signs. It gives you the Libra Resh, which is the four adorations. Okay. And you're supposed to use this to keep your journal. I suck at it. It's something I am going to start working on because I do know the importance of it. And I wish I had been doing the journal all along because there's so many things that develop up here and in here as you move forward in your understanding that it as you're writing, I believe it gives a good meditative thought process to it. So anyway, okay, we're starting to get close on time. I'm going to go through a couple of these other exercises here. The daily tarot card says to obtain a traditional weight tarot deck such as Low Scarabeo's Universal Tarot. Every day in the morning, shuffle the deck. Intend to draw a card that represents an important spiritual issue to focus on for the day. Think of nothing else but that intention as you shuffle. Draw a single card. Look at it openly for several minutes without analyzing or thinking on what you see. Allow yourself to become excited or moved by the image, intentionally amplifying whatever impression you get, if any. You may choose to imagine yourself peering through the card as though a window or doorway, or you may see yourself breathing the atmosphere of the scenery in and out. It would be acceptable at this point to occasionally use this single daily card as a divination. As you shuffle the cards, ask for insight about a current situation. Let the card sit out in the open all day or all night. Come back to it later. Reflect on it again and see if any new insights have come to the surface in regard to the issue or to your current stage of development. Oh, this is such a good one. And we're going to need, I'm going to maybe go on a little bit long with this one. So the Daily Tarot card is very good to begin developing a relationship with your tarot deck. Myself, my favorite tarot deck and my go-to tarot deck is this one, the Witch's Tarot. Okay. I like it. It calls out to me. I have a natural understanding of the cards. The cards seem to flow with me, and so I just use them. You can use a Rider-Waite deck. You don't have to. Okay? Once again, don't get trapped into these boundaries. The magic is about eliminating boundaries. Okay, so the silence exercises. And I'll talk about this one too. Silence exemplifies the spirit of the neophyte grade. Not only is protection from outside forces important, but containment is also a key. Not only are you establishing a barrier that protects your ritual work from outside forces, but you also are learning to keep your aspirations carefully focused within. The following exercises assist with this process. Restricting the topic. For 1 month, preferably the first month of your practice, do not talk with anyone about the following topics: magic, occultism, philosophy, psychology, mysticism, religion, or similar subjects. Keep those in here. listening. For 1 month, say very little in your conversations. Become a good listener. When the time comes for you to speak, instead of vocalizing your opinions and experiences, inquire more about the person you are talking to. Then continue to listen. When asked about your own views, reveal as little as possible and kindly return the conversation to the other person's interests. We are going to stop right there for now. And we're going to talk about silence. Why is that important? If I am working a magical ritual for a specific intent, and I feel very strongly about it, and I feel very positive, and I've done all the rituals, and I've done everything perfect, and I've done all my sigils, and I've drawn in all that energy, and I've been working with candles, or whatever you're wanting to work with. And I put all my intention into this, and I finished the ritual, and I've sent it out to start manifesting. It's great. But If I talk about it to one person and they have any doubt in their mind about it, they have just tainted your entire ritual. They have put that negative energy into it. And every person you talk to about it, you're inviting them into your ritual. You're inviting them into your manifestation. You're inviting them into your spell work. And it's going to destroy it. It is going to destroy it. It's just going to totally fuck it up. Okay? Silence is important. That's the first part of it. The second part of it is humility. Magic is not about ego death, as a lot of people like to say. It's about ego balancing. Carl Jung spoke of the archetypes, and each of the archetypes is equally important, and the idea is to recognize them and to balance them and be able to use them, okay, as parts of ourselves. These archetypes align with the elemental forces, with the planetary forces, with the parts of the psychology that we're going to be studying about. We have to be very careful about wanting to inflate our own ego. Ooh, I cast this ritual and this is what I'm doing and this is what I'm going to say and this is what I'm getting to. Okay, now you are destroying your own spell because you're putting the wrong focus into it. The focus isn't into getting attention for what you're doing. The focus is to get your goal. And your goal never has anything to do with attention toward yourself. Not for the spell. I mean, if you're casting a spell to make yourself more attractive and more charismatic and more beautiful and attract other people, that's great. It's going to happen naturally. It's not going to be because you're talking about your ritual work, okay, or your spell itself. Anybody that follows me on Facebook or Instagram or knows me in person knows that I don't talk about my specific rituals. I will help other people with theirs. I'll give them suggestions. I'll design a ritual for them. But if I'm doing one, I don't talk about it to anyone, ever. Okay? That's incredibly important. Another way of saying this is to look back on the witch's pyramid, which is to know, to dare, to go, to remain silent. So we're going to stop right there. I'm going to wish you well, give you some time to think about that and to meditate on it. As always, please like, subscribe, ask questions in the comments. I love hearing from everyone. There have been some really good comments, and I want to thank all of you for putting the comments in there and helping to spark my brain and watching these videos and coming along with me on this journey. So I hope you guys have a great rest of your day, night, whatever it is, and I hope that we can talk to each other soon. Until then.